this finally lovely day out today. A little wet, but like, don't need a coat. It's pretty great. Thank you for coming to the penultimate event from the Visiting Writers Series. Tonight, I'm super excited to be welcoming Steph Burt to Wells, or for continuing to welcome.
Hi.
Steph gave a wonderful master class this afternoon that several of you made it to, which is great. As always, I'd like to start by thanking NISCA for their support, which makes this reading series possible. And thanks to all of you who came out to the master class as well. I'm Dan Rosenberg, and I'm going to just introduce Steph briefly and then get out of the way. Steph Burt is a poet, a literary critic, and a professor with 8 published books, including 2 critical books on poetry and 3 poetry collections. Burt is a professor of English at Harvard University, and the New York Times called them one of the most influential poetry critics of their generation. The recipient of a 2016 Guggenheim Fellowship, their writing has appeared in the New York Times Book Review, London Review of Books, Times Literary Supplement, The Believer, The Boston Review, you know, the wish list of places you would want your writing to appear in. What I find particularly exciting and illuminating about Steph Burt's critical work is what I'll describe as their modern curatorial impulse, their willingness to engage with new contemporary work and find ways to organize it, to arrange it, so that the trends and trajectories and common impulses and anxieties are visible across a diverse range of poets. Burt identified what used to be called the school in poetry before we became too technologically connected to need real schools. Called one elliptical poetry, later they did something similar, probably new thing. But it's a rare critic who looks at the wild, glorious mess of contemporary poetry and thinks, I can arrange a corner of this, I can find some common framework and shine some light there. In not unrelated news, Burt is a serious poetry critic who writes interesting, surprising, engaging, and beautiful poems. Their criticism is refreshing and invigorating in no small part because they understand poetry from the position not just of a reader or a critic, but of a writer. Their essay collection, Close Calls with Nonsense, was a finalist for the National Book Critics Circle Award, and their most recent collection of essays is called The Poem Is You, 60 Contemporary American Poems and How to Read Them, and that's available for perusal and purchase right here after the show. And in a new game with the bookstore, we have a credit card reader here, so we can do that, which is lovely. And if it doesn't work, we will find a way to take your credit card anyway. So that's recent stuff. The forthcoming books are what we're here to celebrate tonight. First, they have a poetry collection due out this year from Grey Wolf called Advice from the Lights, and our wonderful Book Art Center did a broadside of the title poem, which you can see right here. So thanks to Rich and Savvy and the two, thanks to everyone who made this a reality, including my advanced poetry writing crew who proofread over my shoulder during our break. That was very helpful. And these are for sale at super discount tonight and at lesser discount online after tonight. So that's a collection of poems, and Steph, you also have some copies of a chapbook.
I do, yeah. So this is a chapbook that came out a couple years ago called All Season Stephanie, and they are autobiographical poems about the life that I would have had if I had written a girl. And there's other stuff in it. There's a Baudelaire translation, which I might read. There's a talking paper doll. Lovely things. Yeah.
So
it's a chapbook.
It's a chapbook.
Yeah, a chapbook.
That'll be available as well. And Burt's other forthcoming book, the next critical book, is called Don't Read Poetry, a book about how to read poems. And we're going to get a taste of that tonight as well. So those are the two prongs of tonight's reading slash talk, and I'm excited for it to begin. So please join me in welcoming Stephen Burt.
Thank you to Dan Rosenberg, who's a terrific host, and to Rich at the Center for Book Arts, or is it the Center for Book Arts or Book Arts Center?
Whatever you want.
I'm not the one who worked there. What do you want to know? But thanks to Rich and that center that makes book arts. And thank you for devoting more of your time to me on this beautiful evening. This is a exciting small college with a large event space. And are we being recorded?
Yes.
Okay, then I need to stand here and not sit down unless I can move the microphone.
Can you
turn
that
through?
Move the mic?
Yeah. Okay, because why not just like sit down and treat this as a more intimate space? It just seems more appropriate to why you guys are out here and. Less asymmetrical, I guess. And I don't know if you've noticed, there's something that has to do with our reading habits, with our desires not to be the first people to venture a new or controversial interpretation that explains why people don't sit in the front row. Right? There's also, you don't want to sit in the last front row seat for disability access reasons, but people just don't sit in the front row at all, which is kind of weird. So I'm going to take advantage of that by sitting down in order to have more of a conversation. Yeah?
Yeah.
And I'm gonna talk a little bit about several of the things that Dan described. And you might get up and move around. And if you've got a question that doesn't make sense, just like raise your hand. This is an informal enough gathering that I'm really happy to be interrupted. I'm gonna talk about the Lit Crit project that I just finished and the book that is out, and then I'm going to segue into the book that is now underway, which is Related, and that's going to take about 20 minutes, and then I'm going to read some poems and answer some questions if you've got questions. And you can move closer if you want. Yeah. So I'm going to talk about, there are a lot of different kinds of poetry criticism, and some kinds are really specialized. You are writing for other people who have read all of William Butler Yeats, or other people who read French and Italian and want to discuss Philip Sidney's sources, and that's a good kind of criticism to do, and I sometimes do things like that, though I don't have Italian, so I can't do just that. But I want to talk about writing criticism for real people to read, writing criticism for people who are not professionally involved in the particular sub-branch of poetry writing that you're writing about. And that means younger readers, it means older readers, it means readers who are specializing in something else entirely, it means people who write about novels, it means people who mostly read novels, but sometimes want to see what's up with this other art form called poetry, and it means people who read a lot of poetry but haven't read the poet you're writing about. And I do that a lot. I've been doing it in short forms, book reviewing forms, for a while. And now I do it in books. And the sort of origin of this talk is the difference between the book I just finished, The Poem Is You, 60 Contemporary American Poems and How to Read Them, that's what the book is called, and the next book, Don't Read Poetry, a book about how to read poems. And it turned out, this is the thumbnail version, doing the book I just finished meant deciding what was contemporary, what counted and what was important in contemporary American poetry, and thinking about the variety of poetic practice, which is considerable right now, or close to right now. And the project I'm doing now, the Don't Read Poetry, a book about how to read poems in general project, has meant either deciding or trying not to have to decide what counts as poetry at all. And it's also meant looking at continuity, thinking diachronically, that is, across different time periods, rather than within one. So first, The Poem Is You, the finished book. So this book came about as me reacting as sort of a critic and reader and book reviewer to the people I kept meeting who had read and enjoyed American poetry up through the 70s or 80s, who were really into Elizabeth Bishop and Robert Lowell, or Elizabeth Bishop and John Ashbery maybe, or Elizabeth Bishop and Gwendolyn Brooks, but who didn't really know what was coming next. And then among the people who do read a lot of recent poetry, they sort of divide up into schools. It's almost like some people listen to indie rock, and that's what they listen to, right? Some people listen to jazz, and they only listen to jazz. Some people only listen to soul and R&B and maybe a little bit of hip-hop. Some people only listen to things that sound like trucks backing up in front of amplifiers. Or maybe, you know, that and Shostakovich. That's a problem if you're a music critic, and it's a bigger problem if you're a poetry reader and you like a lot of different kinds of poetry whose readers aren't necessarily talking to each other. And I'll get back to the music analogy later if we have time. I think it's a really important analogy. I think our habits in talking about and reading poetry could be more like our habits now with respect to music. But so there are people who only listen to one kind of poetry. And then there are people who don't really read contemporary poetry at all, and maybe they want to, but they want a travel guide. So that was what I sort of set out to write, and it meant telling or untelling a set of stories about the evolution of contemporary poetry, about a mainstream and a set of margins that reacted against it, or about the development of two or three schools that everybody belonged to, stories that are familiar to people who are in my field, stories that are often usually unintentionally segregationist, that is, they describe the mainstream and margin, and all the people in the mainstream are white, and all the people in the margins are also white, because those African-American poets are sort of off doing something else that is somehow doesn't belong in the same building, and that's stupid. It's sort of more obviously stupid now than it was in, let's say, 1973, when a number of interesting African-American poets really wanted to be in a different building, the sort of black arts movement moment. Obviously, American poetry, like America, is not only people who think they're white and African-American people, it's lots of other demographics. And it's also lots of forms. There's not a mainstream way of writing poetry and then an avant-garde way. There are lots of different ways, and they talk to each other horizontally. And I wanted to sort of show that happening. And it turned out the best way to show that happening to try to broaden people's listening habits was to write a book about 60 different poems that connected the poems to one another and to earlier poems and to things outside poetry. There's one essay on a poem that is deeply connected to debates about evolution by natural selection. Not whether it happens, but how it happens and how fast it happens and what makes it happen and how it's affected by climate change. And there's another poem that's a Lucille Clifton poem that's early in the book, where in order to see what she's doing in the poem, you have to look at debates about womanism and black feminism and debates about reproductive freedom and abortion rights in the 70s. And then there's another poem that is a set of mostly couplets and rhyming, rhymed and metered portraits of a horse that are also about the future of the American labor movement, that are also about the future of left-wing evangelical Christianity, which this poet thinks, I think correctly, is an important part of the future of the labor movement and is best represented by a series of figurative horses that also stand for abandoned middle school art projects that are also the Statue of Liberty. Her name is Alyssa Range, and if you are someone who would like to read poets writing in traditional rhymed and metered forms, who are really good, who are really political, who are really intelligent, and who are under 40, she may be, I don't know how old she is, but I'm sure she's under 40, Melissa Range, R-A-N-G-E, is the person you should be reading right now. There's two books. Anyway, a lot of these books. It's a book that I wanted as the first, and I suppose now the only President Clinton, this talk was written a little while ago, sorry, as the first President Clinton, sorry, said of his cabinet, it's a book that tries to look like America. And if you've heard that phrase before, which some of you have and some of you haven't, you know that it's impossible to make a small selected group of anything, homes or people or furniture, look like America. There are too many Americans. But you can try. You have to think about what that would mean. And I was looking not just for the kind of diversity that the Bureau of the Census collects information about, diversity of people, but also, and this is really ultimately more important, since it's a book of poems, not a book of human beings, diversity of approach and background and style and forms, and of course all free verse also has a form. Forms doesn't just mean does it rhyme or do you count the syllables. Stylistic diversity, and tonal diversity, and emotional diversity, and diversity of subjects. And I wanted to do this, and you know, only to include poems that I liked. And I think I got it right. And the experience of trying to do this was an experience that taught me a lot. It taught me pretty fast that I could not include every form I liked, every topic that interested me, or every significant demographic. And I'm still conscious of what forms are not there, what topics are not there, and what sort of demographics are not there. I started by putting in the poems that I felt had to be there, or the poem, and or the in a few cases, like the title poem, the poems I knew had to be there, and the poems I loved so much, there was no way I was leaving them out. And then I kept going back and looking at the stack and saying, what's missing, what's missing, what's missing, what else should I look at? And I got a good deal of feedback from Harvard Press, from John Colcom, editor of Harvard Press, who said, no, you don't have to put that in, or in a few cases, no, you have to put that in. There are a couple of poets who I decided to include partly because he said, you know, you got them. There were a couple poets he said, you know, you should really put this person in because they're very famous and important. And I just said, I don't like them enough. I'm sorry. So I ended up, partly through these negotiations, partly through just looking at the staff and saying, you know, does it need to be loud there, to be quiet there, does it need some syllabics over there, is there a sestina, things like that. Got some variety, and it really drove me to reading poets and styles of poetry that I didn't know I would like or didn't know existed or didn't think I would understand 5 years ago when I started writing this book. In some cases, that's because they're relatively new poets where their work wasn't known or hadn't been written. 6 or 7 years ago, Rosa Alcala and Gabby Bess, who was an alt-lit poet. I don't know if alt-lit is still a thing. People who are sort of digital natives, who are used to publishing on Tumblrs, whose styles reflect the concerns of sort of growing up with everything on a Tumblr or on an Instagram. So learning what Gabby Bess was doing and where that came from. And that was the kind of poetry I didn't know I would like 5 years ago because it didn't, it barely existed. And then other kinds of poets, and where I had to learn the background to learn what the poet was doing and why. And the best example of that for me is the New Yorican stuff from the 80s that is heavily connected not just to the circumstances of performance, to this poem is written for you to imagine it being read live, but also to the social linguistic habits of the New Yorican, the New York Puerto Rican community. And I learned more about the history of that community, which is not a heritage community for me, in the course of reading the person who turned out really to be my favorite New Yorican poet, a guy named Pedro Pietri, who's not in the book because all of his best poems are too long for the book. And also the much more famous and quite good Tata La Vieira, who is the writer I ended up including. One of the things I learned, by the way, is that New Yorican doesn't really mean New York Puerto Rican. Until the mid-80s, it was a negative word that when it was often meant that someone was not authentically Puerto Rican because their speech habits and tastes were too African-American. I knew nothing about this clash that was internal to sort of the tri-state area. Until I read the books by the several critics who really work on this, who are from that community. And the best one, and this is really a model of how to write a lit crit book, it's a guy called Aurelio Noel, who I also wanted to put in the book, but his best poems are all either too long or entirely in Spanish.
And the book includes a couple of poems that are multilingual, but I decided not to put in poems that were not in English at all, for reasons of audience and space. And those are from early in his career. Now he writes deeply, deeply bilingual poems. They're often visual poems. They're often 15-page long projects. He's really good, but he's not in the book. But he helped me write the book with his criticism. Orion Noel. Anyway, that was how I put this together. And you can see it was hard for me to figure out who to put in and what to be reading. And hard to pick poem 59 and poem 60 and to leave out poem 61. And if you follow college basketball, yes, you know, I'm not sure which result you're applauding.
The fact that you're following college basketball?
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm only following the women, but Mississippi State over Baylor was a great result, and my wife went to UConn, so we have to be UConn fans.
Wow.
But the Oregon Ducks are a team to follow. Like, the Oregon men are still in it also, aren't they?
Yes.
Yeah, no. I only follow the women of the council. If you follow any college basketball, you know the thing where the bracket gets second guessed, and who should the committee have put in, who should they have left out. This really felt like that. And you're going to get, you know, hit by the fans of the team that was probably the first one out. Fortunately, there's no bracket. There's not like one winner. And that's actually an important way to think about poetry criticism. You do construct a bracket or construct a set of things you recommend, but they don't play each other until you have a winner. There is no single champion poem. There is no best poem. There are only poems you like more and that you like less and that mean more to you and mean less to you, and they mean different things to you, and I'll come back to that. And also basketball is great. So it was hard for me to sort of figure out what went in and what had to go out, and you know, I know what I would have put in had I had more space. I know who I would have put in if I could have included people whose best poems are 10 pages long, like Julian Spahr, S-P-A-H-R, who is also an interesting political thinker. But I did know when I wanted the book to start. It seemed really clear to me that 1981 was a time when many, many things changed. That if you want to tell a story about American literary culture, 1981 is a very good hinge. The 60s ended when Reagan got in. And people who wanted a lot of change in the direction of social justice and inclusion started playing defense in a lot of ways. And the one clear sort of political field where that might look like it's not true, which has to do with LGBT inclusion. The early 80s are a big hinge in another way, and you can guess why. If cases isn't in all of your mind, people start dying of HIV. And it turned out to be fairly easy to represent the HIV crisis in a book of 60 contemporary American poems from the early 80s till now. That was one of the things that I had to be careful not to overrepresent, along with New York City and California and what's another example? We'll let those examples stay for now. So 1981 is when a lot of things change, and it turns out there's an emblematic poem about how to read modern poetry and why, called Paradoxes and Oxymorons by John Ashbery, that I could just put at the front. Yeah, that's the first poem in there. The sort of, the last problem I had to solve in writing the book was, who's American? And that's much harder because there's so many poets who are clearly attached to other countries, either because they came here from St. Lucia or from Northern Ireland or from Singapore, or because they wrote in other languages while they lived here, like Jesua Miłosz, Solomon, Peter Solomon. I ended up going with one poem where I printed the English translation. It's I think, a really important poem in a lot of ways, and it ended up being one of the two poems that spoke to 9/11. 9/11 didn't have a lot of impact on American poetry. Hurricane Katrina had a much bigger impact. There are way more poems in there, entire books that are pretty good that are Hurricane Katrina books. There are no books of poetry written in reaction to September 11, 2001 that are poetry that are good, as far as I can tell. There are individual poems that are pretty good. But I ended up finding a poem by Czesław Miłosz that begins, "Human reason is beautiful and invincible." That, yeah, you know it. And Robert Pinsky, who is not otherwise in the book, created a tremendously powerful, clear translation of that poem. So I was able to represent translation, and I was able to represent people who live here but are from somewhere else and are attached to that place in that language. So that was a hard problem to solve. And the result, if I got this right, was a project for a particular well-defined time frame. The moment of America from 1981 to 2016. With a national culture, with, I hope, a great deal of variety. And the book sort of says, if you like poetry, here's some contemporary poetry from America. And I'm going to help you read it. But what is poetry? How do you know if you like poetry? If someone asks, why do you like poetry, what kind of answer do you give? Does it depend on your example? Are you satisfied with the answer that you give? And the history of responses to the questions, what is poetry? And there's a John Ashbery poem called What is Poetry? That's quite good and quite funny. The history of responses to the question, what is poetry? And the related question, why should I read poetry? Why should my dad read poetry? Why should my little brother and sister read poetry? What good is poetry? The history of answers to those questions is all over the place. It includes what people say, JK, it includes jokes that are just kidding but not kidding. Like Frank O'Hara saying, if you don't need poetry, bully for you, of American poets, only Whitman, Crane, and Williams are better than the movies. And that's actually quite true. If you don't need poetry, that's fine. Not everybody needs every art form. But O'Hara was making a serious point about don't ask poetry to do everything, or you'll find that you won't believe the claim that it made on its behalf. Percy Bysshe Shelley, the sort of great and sometimes ridiculous Romantic period poet, said that poets are the unacknowledged legislators of the world, creating the ways of thought and feeling that the future, and for Shelley this meant a revolutionary future in a good sense, would follow. And W.H. Auden, who's I feel closer to in a lot of ways, said, no, poets are not the unacknowledged legislators of the world. You're thinking of the secret police. Auden, who was reacting against the popularity of his own earlier poetry, some of which urged young British people to go and fight and die for communism in Spain, which didn't work out all that well, partly in reaction against that, Auden said later that if poetry has any ethical purpose or ulterior good that it does, it is to disenchant and disintoxicate. Which I think goes way too far. I would not endorse that statement. But it's important to me that Auden made it. And it's been important to me to see all of the different accounts, even just from the last 80 years, of what this thing called poetry is and what it does. Because none of them, no single account, speaks to all of the things that relatively compact, acoustically interesting, verbally crafted objects, things that we usually call poems, do. There's just not a definition that is broad enough to incorporate these things. And that's really clearly true if you look back past 1980 and past 1950 and 1920. Poetry, broadly defined, if you take what math people call the union of its definitions instead of the intersection, can do almost anything that any kind of language can do. It can include long narrative, it can include long prose narrative, it includes, for Philip Sidney, writing in Shakespeare's time, it includes things that today we would call high fantasy novels. Right, does Kat Valente write poetry? Well, her novels include verse, so a little, but not mostly.
does Tolkien write poetry? Again, his novels include verse. But for Philip Sidney, the entirety of The Lord of the Rings is poetry. Poetry, even if you just mean verse, includes functions that today are performed by The Daily Show and The Samantha Bee Show. In 18th century America, there's a thing called versification, which doesn't mean learning to write sonnets. It means writing verse parodies of prose documents and prose arguments. A versifier in New York or Philadelphia in 1750 has the same job description as somebody who's writing for John Oliver today. Except it happens to be in verse. So poetry now mostly does a set of things that we usually call lyric. And Jonathan Collar, who is the great theorist of lyric at Cornell, thinks, and he has a new book called Theory of the Lyric, and I disagree with a lot of his earlier books, but I agree with a lot of what's in this one. Not a lot of it. He thinks lyric is a nearly trans-historical category, that this thing called lyric poetry, which isn't the same as all poetry, but this thing called lyric poetry, should we open a window because it's hot? Yeah, let's open a window. Nobody wants to talk about literature in like a greenhouse. So one of the sort of standard, thank you, Dan. Yeah, more windows. The two sort of standard ways of thinking about lyric are, one, it's poetry that is in some way like songs, but isn't songs, that evolves out of songs. And the other is, we're opening the windows, that lyric work, lyric poetry, lyric language, takes you into yourself. It's introspective, it's about the inner life, instead of taking you out the window, out of yourself, into other stuff and history and the world, like the novel. And it's sort of odd that these could both be true, but they both say something important about how these relatively short, relatively usually complicated, feelingful, personal, but also somehow not personal because you can share them with strangers and they make sense, bundles of language called lyric poems, how they work now. And with The Poem Is You, I ended up very quickly with two answers to the question of what does poetry do now better than stage plays or New York Times editorials or Twitter or realist prose fiction. One of them is what Collar would I think call lyric, and what Helen Vendler, another critic I usually agree with, is a colleague of mine in Massachusetts, what Helen Vendler says that lyric does, which is that it's about the inner life. It conveys not your outward experience, not sort of how much money you make, or exactly what you do in bed, or what happened at your uncle's funeral, but what it's like to grieve, what it's like for you to be turned on, what it's like for you to feel broke or feel suddenly flush. The inner life. And then the other thing that poetry in general now does really well is innovation, weirdness, using language in a way that makes you say, what? That's never been done before. And these things sound like the opposite. One of them, it speaks to feelings you two might have. One of them, it makes you say, what the heck, what is that? They sound like opposites in theory. Really, they go together in practice all the time. You can have a poem that makes you say, what? Oh. Or a poem that makes you say, I've absolutely felt that way, but I've never thought to put it like that. Or a poem that makes you say, oh, that way of feeling is more complicated than I thought. So, feeling the inner life and difficulty, innovation, weirdness. And it turned out, as I realized that I wanted to write a book about why people read poetry in general, what kinds of poems are out there, why you might try reading more of it, and how you might share your interest in poetry with others, that these two explanations weren't quite enough. So the book that I'm trying to write right now, that is midway through and I'm almost done with the me talking about myself part of the evening, then I'll just read a few poems and have a conversation. Want to have a conversation? Yeah. It turns out that there are six. six, count them, six reasons why you might read poems. And to see these six, you have to read contemporary poetry, and you also have to read some poetry by dead people who've been dead for a while. But they're not always the same dead people and the same contemporary poems. And you also have to give up on the idea that there's a thing called poetry that's always good for you in the same way, in the way that, like, penicillin is always good for you in the same way. Or, you know, apples. It turns out, you know, poetry is more like food. For me, I would have a hard time living without any of it. But what apples do for you is different. It's different from what durian fruit do for you. And if you're familiar with durian fruit, you know that not everyone likes it. And they're different. They do different things from what, like, you know, tofu does for you. We read different poems for different reasons, and we see that better if we read lots of poems, and some of them come from the past. So these are the six things. The first one is that lyric function, feeling and attitude. Sharing with you, allowing you to think about or to almost experience what it would be like to have a certain feeling, and you may have had that in the past. You may be having it now. That's why people share poems often at weddings and at funerals. But also the feeling of outrage, the feeling of frustration, the feeling of being broke, which I think is a feeling, and the feeling of having a lot of material resources, which is also a feeling. Langston Hughes, by the way, is very good on that. He's our great American poet of financial feelings, among other things, many other things. The feeling of being included, the feeling of being excluded, the feeling of being bullied, the feeling of having been the bully, the feeling of being saved from physical danger. All of these things are feelings that you can share with others through poetry. And that's sort of the lyric function, finding words for that. The second one is related to that. It's different, character and personality. When you meet a new person who's a person, you might, especially if you like the person, discover how much you have in common with them, that you've had the same experiences or that you feel the same way. But you're also meeting someone who's not you, who's an individual, and you're getting to know them in all of their particularity, their weirdness. That way of putting across character and personality, sometimes just through a poet's style, sometimes through what happens in the poem, so that you really feel not like you're speaking a part and taking emotion into yourself, but getting to know a new person. That is the second thing. Some of you are thinking about Robert Browning, who is famous for creating characters, and he's in that chapter, but you know, so is Laura Koschisky, so is Sam Rivera, so is Tata LaViera, actually, in the New York Recon's game. Third thing, pattern and skill. Are we talking basketball? Even if you don't care who wins the game, seeing a really skillful assist, and a, you know, a double screen set, and I encourage you to watch UConn, if you're not doing that already and you like any sports at all. There's a great deal of pleasure in seeing things that are very hard to do and take practice and take thought and also take non-intellectual skills. With poetry, it's just having an ear, having musical skills, seeing these things done really well. People who call themselves formalists, which is a vexed word I don't usually like, often say this is the virtue in poetry that matters most to them, and some poems don't obviously provide that. Anything good has a form of some kind, but a poem that just seems like a rant, a poem that just seems like emotion exploding at you, you have to really study it to see that it has a form. This virtue of pattern and the display of skill, a goal that is a hard goal accomplished, is most obvious in closed inherited forms where you know what the problem to be solved in is with sestinas, with certain kinds of sonnets, with terza rima. But you can see it, of course, in free verse as well, and sometimes it is right out there out front. But what about when you don't know what the poet's trying to do, when you say they're trying to do something with what? Or when the poem just makes you say what in general and it doesn't make prose sense? Well, that can be a pleasure. The pleasure of difficulty, of frustration, of poems that make you go, I know people whose whole taste in poetry comes from looking for more and more difficulty, more and more frustration, more and more resistance to prose sense, to the way the world ordinarily works, to the apparently transparent language of please sign the dotted line, of and the Battle of Yorktown was the last battle of the American War of Independence, of you can't go out dressed like that. Poetry can be a form of resistance to all of those kinds of apparently transparent language. Some people who write poetry as if think poetry is a form of resistance in that sense of difficulty, write poetry that is obviously like, what? There are a group of people called who were called the language poets in the 70s and 80s, and some of them are really still writing. And one of them, Greg Armentrout, is one of my favorite poets, who were famous for writing poems that didn't seem to make sense. And some of them thought that this was a way of resisting capitalism. But there are also people who will tell you, and Rainer Maria Rilke, the great sort of German late romantic poet, is one of them, that their poems are difficult because having a soul is difficult, and they express the difficulty of being in a world that is not made for us. And the difficulty in their poems is not the difficulty of putting two words together and figuring out where the verb is, but of figuring out exactly what they're trying to do with language that's apparently transparent. So the last two things that poems do are, this is number five, wisdom and purpose. High school teachers tell you that poems have to have morals, and they have to get you to do something, and they have to improve you, and then college teachers tell you, no, they don't. No, stop looking for an answer, a solution, for directions, for action, for moral improvement. And actually, some poems do want you to do something, and some don't. Often, people who really want poems to get you to do something value wisdom and purpose in poetry. They want poems to give you generalizations. Audrey Rich, her wounds came from the same source as her power. You know, Robert Frost, before I build a wall, I want to know what I'm walling in and walling out. Sir John Harington, treason doth never prosper. What's the reason? For if it prosper, none dare call it treason. That is memorable general language. It's not memorable because it introduces you to a character or to someone's inner complex structure of feeling or because it's difficult. It is a general truth that we should keep in mind, and it will make us better and more aware. So wisdom. And then the last thing, history and community. I would like good poems to speak to everyone, to people who are very much like the poet, and to people who are nothing like the poet in outwardly. But many poems also speak to a set of people the poet is representing or speaking to that's not all possible readers or people of our time. There are poems that are addressed in particular to children. There are poems that are addressed in particular to teachers. There are poems that are addressed in particular to New Zealanders. There are poems that are addressed in particular to Filipino Americans. There are poems that are addressed in particular to white Southerners after the U.S. Civil War. And not all of them are sort of what you may think of first. Poems often, if you're reading them historically, or if you're reading them as someone who's distant in time or space or background from that community, can teach you a lot about that community. A lot of these poems are poems that used to be thought of as minor or not worth studying. Some of them were me, but some of them I really have learned a lot from. The poems of Chartism, the working class movement of 1830s England. And of course, if you are a member of a community that a poem addresses, it can do a lot of things for you about solidarity, about making you feel that you belong, about showing you a way forward and a way background, a way backwards. The great number of modern African-American poems that address in some way the Middle Passage, the sort of genocidal transport of African people to the United States and the Caribbean and in ships that killed people, that is a central thing in the poems of, in the longest and most famous poem by Robert Hayden, in a number of poems by Terence Hayes, who does, by the way, if you read all of Terence Hayes, you find him doing all of the six things that I just described, but not all at once, not all in the same poem. And it's okay if you're not looking for all six. But I do want you to know that they're all available. And the way to know they're all available is to stop trying to read and defend and or attack a thing called poetry and to start reading poems. And I think I will stop there and read a few poems.
Yeah.
So I haven't read you any poems in full. I'm going to read you one poem by a friend of mine, someone who I was conflicted out of writing about this book when it came out at length, because I've been following her writing for a long time. It would be unethical for me to publish a book review saying this is a great book. Just because you can't do that for someone who's a friend. But it is not unethical for me to read you one of her poems. And the poet is Monica Yoon, Y-O-U-N, and the book is called Blackacre. And it was a nominee for like every major award this year. And a lot of it is about the experience of infertility, about wanting to get pregnant and have a child and finding that that is difficult or in some ways impossible. And she's a mom now, and if you look at interviews done after Blackacre went to press, she talks about having written an infertility book and now being a mom, and they're fascinating interviews. She's also a legal scholar who did election law for quite a while with the Brennan Center for Justice. If you follow the law and voting rights in particular, you want to follow the Brennan Center. So when people interview Monica now, she tends to talk about voting and elections and whether we can preserve the rule of law in this country or not. And I suspect that will be in some of her future poems, but this is a lot of it's about female embodiment and about history. And it alludes to classical Greece and to medieval France and to a lot of different places. This is, which one should I read you? I'll read you one of the Hanged Man poems. Which are responses, we have a French historian in the audience, the responses to a poem called Ballad of the Hanged Man, only it's called that in French, by the great French late medieval poet François Villon, who was a thief, who was imprisoned, who was famous for writing about his exploits. So this is Monica Yoon, Y-O-U-N, Lamentation of the Hanged Man. The minor winds hemmed all around with little brass hooks of birdsong. They fasten on me bonelessly. Failed wings. They tug at me, each with its own pained sense of imperative. I am always turning in the same idiot arcs, always facing the horizon's white-lipped sneer. How I would love to flatten myself against the ground, to stop the small, crying blacknesses of my body with the all-sufficing blackness of the earth. Even now, a rake of small-toothed owls is dragging toward us, combing out the hills. If only I were lying still, pressed to the ground, I might be taken for part of the earth, tilled into the soil like any other enrichment. Like labor. Monica Yoon's really good. Yeah, why are you there? I don't want to take up more of your time than you have, but I think I'm supposed to read a couple poems by me, and we'll have some time for Q&A. Okay, I'll read some. I'll get a couple things from All Season Stephanie, and I've got a couple a couple that are available if you want one of those. My publisher would be really sad if I didn't remind you that you can buy the poems you hear. I'm literally obligated to remind you to do that, and I'm really proud of it. I hope that people will. A couple new poems, and then some poems from All Season Stephanie. And I'll read things from Advice from the Lights, which is in press right now. I'm going to come home and find the galleys, and you know, last chance to remove anything I don't like anymore. Good problem to have.
I'm so sorry.
That was perfect, actually. It was like the punctuation between I am talking about poems by others to my poems. So I promised you at least one more trans or gender non-conforming inanimate object. Cardboard matchbox. On a bad day, it seems to me I have too many heads. On better days, I feel more like a nest, a half-open secret, a concatenation of ruby-throated hummingbirds, none of them eager to fledge or fend for themselves just yet. My history is the history of industry, of making one way to breathe in the sun into so many separable planks of obvious utility, and then of labor to further divide me into straight segments that pass a mechanical test. I at least look like I can take a joke, though like everything else about me, it has to be dry. As a matter of chemistry and brittle risk aversion or natural reticence, I keep my potential energy strictly inside. I live for now in a perpetual future tense. Each time you open me up, another part of me burns. One day I will have nothing to hide. I think it's finished.
Is that finished yet?
Yeah. So read you maybe two more really new ones and two from All Season Stephanie. But if we're gonna do that, since this is a beautiful, large, hot room where air does not circulate at all for some reason, I think we should all stand up and sit down. Seriously, just stand up and then sit down. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. '78 Stephanie. 1. I made myself. Mommy and Daddy were proud in that order. I didn't mail myself like a letter some other kids already knew. I learned to use stamps. They stuck to my thumb without any glue. I didn't have any permission. 2. There was a snowstorm that lasted 3 days and a cavern of monochrome memory. There were board games and a pencil and paper game where the object was to figure out the object of the game. There was a stack of broad roll writing paper and a stapled calendar and a 64-pack of sparkly rainbow crayons to make each week look different since they all started out black and white and all the same. 3. Oh, grapefruit as color and flavor. Oh, never quite rightly tied laces. Oh, look up there on the uneven climbing bars. Too hot to touch where the sun touches. Now that it's spring, the shadow of a tarp like a sail between sailors and thin swings that make no decision like weather vanes. Oh, think of the lost Chuck Taylors, the lost Mary Janes. First kiss, Stephanie. Gummy candy passed back and forth and slightly stale. But if I did like boys, one more of these, the new one. Sports poem. So there's like a WNBA poem in Belmont, which is the last one, and then there's a gymnastics poem here. It's, it takes a little, really happy with it, but it's maybe a little too long to read.
We're okay with long.
You think? Yeah? Really? Okay. Are there people in here who sort of know about gymnasts and know about gymnastics at all? Okay, correct me if there are mistakes. This one is actually going into Advice with the Lights. So if there are gymnastic mistakes, okay. There's still time. Gymnastic Stephanie. I am in at least two sorts of race with my body, where with means both riding in and by means of, and against, viewing it as a competitor. What can I get myself to learn to do and to do as soon as possible in the competitive moment or minute or day or month or calendar year before its changes take the willingness or the supposedly fearless patience, whatever that means, or the ability away? Practice, 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 look at me, practice. Don't look at me, head over head, over heels, over head, over heels. Practice, practice. Whether any of the people watching me who have not done the things I do know what I can do or what I have been trying to do or how hard it can be or how easy it seemed before I knew what I was doing, not that I know what I am doing now. Practice beyond the interminable practice might be the effortless practice, practice, or apparently effortless practice, or something like joy. Only my peers understand me if they do. Maybe I have no peers. To prepare for years, to concentrate for the entirety of a life, short as it seems to adults, to see eternity as a warm-up and a walk-through for a minute and a half, to be and to show what you are, over and steady, two hurdles, flick-flack, this is what you had practiced, practice, practice. To have become someone who has to be only what you show the world. That's what you are. So soon it will be what you were. The rotation, the rounded arc, the stick that casual fans and families know. The return from infinite vertical space into human time. What is amazing to amateurs has to become second nature. No marvel, a stopwatch to me. Two hurdles, flick-flack. This is what you had practiced, practice, practice. Two folds more. There used to always be a balance beam in my dreams, and the sensation of turning over and over, the pale blue and all too exciting wish never to land, to have become someone who has to be only what you show the world. That's what you are. So soon it will be what you were. I'm going to end with another short one, it's gone through a lot of titles, one of which was a joke about Burt that was just didn't work. So right now it's called To the Defenders of Borders. By the wrought iron roots of the wrought iron fence at the gravel and pebble-lined edge of our town's only six-way intersections, Pocket Park. Stay and fight for each crumb, says every beak, their fierce defense, their almost confident peak. If I had wings to fly away, I'd need another language, say, of pigeons' iridescent repetitions and their miniature clash, their whistles and contested brass, their flutter and bothersome righteous claim to belong, having come from elsewhere like the grass. Letting me share a new work. I just changed one of the words in there.
That's the wrong word.
If you're not sick of me, we can do a quick Q&A. And then I owe it to the people who publish my books to remind you that they exist. Are you able to have, can I put some of these with you also? And I'm really so grateful to Wells in general, to the Wells community, to the people who showed up this morning. And to the people who came out tonight, and also to Rich for making this thing, which Dan has you've done so much. Like, you, I hope you know, like, what an amazing asset you have in being able to do all the things you've done. And if you're not reading his own poetry, there are several books that you can order to read. That you probably are. Yeah.
I have a question.
Yeah.
I mean, you do this anthology. I'm so interested in this process. What do you find is merging in poetry with, and especially the period you're talking about, geographically? You know, are there parts of the country, for example, that's producing more and different or better kinds of poetry?
Oh, God, yes.
Okay, yeah. I'm just curious what those are, if you could say.
So we're influenced by what we read and who we are and what happens to us. And we're also influenced by like who we meet and where who our friends are and what we see around us. And sometimes we even move, and we can move to be with people who are like us. Sometimes we move to a place that has, especially if we're relatively young and relatively mobile, which many young people, of course, are not, we move to a place that has the cool kids who think like us. And there's a lot of cool kid poetry being written in Brooklyn today. Some of it's very interesting, especially the stuff that's part of a movement called the Girlesque that's connected to sort of teenage girls in popular culture and sort of post-Buffy poetry, I want to say. There are also a lot of sort of cool indie rock dudes writing in Brooklyn for each other who weirdly are connected to the translation of very demanding works from Slavic languages. And there's a press called Ugly Duckling Press that publishes sort of three kinds of poetry. Poetry that is deeply and innovatively engaged with sort of teen girl popular culture, and cool dude indie rock poetry that's mostly boring, and translations of very challenging work from Slavic languages. And that is very regionally specific. Ugly Duckling Press could not exist in New Mexico. On the other hand, Nolomi Press, which was founded and is still co-run by the very talented poet Carmen Jimenez-Smith, could not probably exist in New York City, although it could exist in a number of places, probably Chicago. Actually, they could. It could not have been founded in New York City. It is now a thriving operation that does challenging and sort of wild sort of high-octane American poetry generally, and has a separate imprint called the Acrylic Imprint that does young Latina Chicana writers. Anything that the Nomi Press has put out is going to be at least sort of interesting and wild and challenging. They have a lot of books, I don't really call their books, but again, it matters where that is. There are sort of other examples. For a while, Minnesota, where I used to live, was famous for sort of quiet dudes on the prairie being religious. Right, Robert Bly, whose poetry I mostly don't like, and James Wright, whose poetry I really do like very much, and who would not have become an interesting poet without Robert Bly. Again, it's important to have a scene. And the same people can be kind of bad poets and really good influences. It's important to have a scene. Those are examples of scenes that don't rely on a person going somewhere to study with a famous big deal teacher, but other scenes do. The Iowa Writers' Workshop is the most famous example of that, right? Iowa City influences people who live there. There are Iowa poets. Robin Sheff is in Iowa right now. She moved there to study at the Iowa Writers' Workshop with Jory Graham and others and sort of stayed. And her poetry would be very different if she were living in Denver or Miami. But she went to Iowa not because she was attached to farms or the Midwest or to Senator Tom Harkin, but because Jory Graham and other terrific poets were there and has a reputation as a place that creates poets. And there are other places that did not have that kind of reputation in 1981 that sort of do now. Washington University in St. Louis is a very good graduate writing program, and we're seeing the results. The University of Southern California, not everyone likes LA, I like it, but I never lived there, has poets and critics teaching there who are very senior and very famous and agree on absolutely nothing at all. And they have a long tradition of sort of post-beat, very non-academic poetry. And so if you move to L.A., or if you're from there, you get exposed to sort of Marjorie Perloff, the very famous literary critic, telling you that if something makes sense, then it's out of date. And David St. John, who is a great teacher of poets, telling you that your poems have to be lyrical and really have heart and be compact. And you get Hollywood as a kind of big rival, and you have to justify writing poetry in a town that depends on other kinds of art. And you hear Spanish every day, and it never rains, and they're always about to run out of water. And all of those things affect the great poetry that's come from Los Angeles that could not have come from anywhere except Southern California, and over the past few decades. I hope that was a good enough answer.
Yes. I don't hear you mention the southern region, though.
Oh, God, I'm sorry. Usually when I give this talk, I talk about C.D. Wright, like, for 15 minutes.
Okay.
One of the great poets of our time passed away a little more than a year ago. C.D. Wright, right, the Wright brothers, initials C.D. Tremendous variety of work, much of which was connected to her Arkansas background or to her collaborators in Georgia and Louisiana. Southern language, southern landscapes, the sort of fertility of the plant life, southern ways of doing and southern ways of fighting social injustice. But this, I mean, the American South is not one thing either. C.D. Wright would be a very different poet if she were from Richmond, Virginia, which is definitely the South.
Yeah.
You know, Charlottesville, actually, because of the University of Virginia, the poets who have been there has been a locus of different ways of being Southern. There are people who think the greatest living American poet is Charles Wright, who is very much a poet of the Blue Ridge and of isolation. And of great vistas and of comfort in the landscape. You couldn't, Charles Wright, he's good, he's in the book. You couldn't be Charles Wright if you couldn't be comfortable in your landscape. And to be comfortable in your landscape, you have to be in mountains that won't kill you in January. If you're him. You know, he wouldn't exist as a poet of Minnesota or El Paso. I want to hear students, I'm sorry, yeah, hi.
So, in jazz music, a big thing is you don't play the notes that are there, you play the bright notes, you. And right at the end of your last poem, you said that you changed the word because it wasn't the right word. So I just want to know, what were you thinking when you read that word and changed it?
So the pigeons who are supposed to emerge in the course of the poem as people who have as much right as people who have as much right to be in America as sort of white people whose ancestors were here 200 years ago, I don't know what birds those would be. Pigeons, by the way, really are immigrants. And grass really is an immigrant. Like, what would be leaves of grass, looks for me to maybe boot soles. The kind of grass that grows on lawns in temperate climates was brought here from Europe and actually displaced native grasses, familiar story. You know, most of the things that are native, that we think of as native with the lowercase n, are actually immigrants. But so those pigeons are supposed to emerge as, you know, combative and flawed, but ultimately I want us to be on their side, and I don't want to duplicate, use the word defense in the poem. I think it belongs in the title only, and I want to use some other, actually quieter word like resolve, which also has softer consonants, so that the words that stand out in that stanza are the words confident and peak, which doesn't work if you say defense. So, this is why I like doing things like this, where I can read you great poems. Thanks for your patience. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Couple more?
Yeah. Gemma?
Yes.
Yeah.
Same question about identity politics.
Okay.
Yeah. And so in a call that you us earlier about time capsule, you said, it says, my answer to everything is, it's only too early to say, no, I'm ready to lead a long delay. And then in your matchbook poem, sorry, I didn't
know,
you said, live for now in perpetual future tense. And so much when I think about my gender is something that is not what I am now, but something that, or like what other potential things I can be. So I was wondering if you could respond to those two lines a little bit, because I really dig it. Also, thank you for being here. It's been very interesting.
Really very lucky because I get to be transfeminine in public, and I have a great deal of job security, and I have support from either sort of baffled support from cisgender colleagues who were like, oh, okay, or much warmer sort of understanding support, and at home generally I've been very lucky in a lot of ways. And I want to remind people in the audience who are already thinking about that not everyone, not all trans people can be out at all, right? Some people are living as who they are inside, and who we are inside in a total stealth, right? Just 20 years ago, people used to say, yeah, you know gay people, you just don't know that you know them. Like, you know trans people, even if you you don't think that you know them, and you probably do know people who are about as trans, so yay. And I'm one of them. Hi. There's two different things, you know, that you identified. One of them is true, I think, of trans identity in general, and one of them is true of some of us, but not others. So the one that's true of trans identity in general is that who we are is to some extent narrative. It's about how we became who we were. There are philosophers who think that personal identity is narrative anyway. There's one I like called Mario Schechtman, who says that the only way to think about who you are generally is to think about telling a consistent story about what you did and who you are and why. And I have some sympathy with that. If you can't tell a consistent story about your life, then so you have philosophical problems as well as emotional ones. But to identify as transgender is to say the gender that I was assigned, and maybe the gender I'm still being assigned, doesn't match who I am inside, and I'm going to do something about it. I'm going to talk about it, right? That's what coming out means. I am going to at least sort of contemplate whether I want to take steps to bring how other people see me and how I move through the world visually and sort of kinesthetically and physically more in line with who I feel I am inside, right? Like, people thought that I was a boy when I was a child, and I didn't really tell them that I wasn't. It was a while ago. I don't know if they would have understood, probably not. And it took me a while to find the story about myself that was comprehensible to others that also fit me. And I'm still telling that story, partly because everyone is still telling a story about moving from who you were to who you're going to become, and partly in ways that are sort of, you know, apply to me and not to, like, Jennifer Finney Boylan, to name a terrific, talented, and very accessible trans writer who is writing mostly for cisgender people who want to understand. If you want to read a transfeminine work that is amazing and revelatory, written for a transfeminine audience, you want to read a novel called Nevada by Imogen Binney, B-I-N-N-I-E. If you want to read a transmasculine author writing for transmasculine people primarily, the best prose stylist in the cluster of those authors for me is probably a writer named Burt Bergman, who identified as a butch lesbian early, acquired a terrifically entertaining prose style, and now identifies as a trans guy. Oh, good, you know Burt Bergman. Okay.
I think he's a senior.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Good. Okay. Yeah, I've done an event with terrific presence.
Yeah.
Okay, you're way ahead of me.
Yeah.
So some of us have sort of taken all of the steps that we're going to take and all the steps we feel that we need to take to have the outside match the inside as much as possible, to be as visually and kinesthetically and socially, and in some cases legally congruent with who we want to be, right? It says, oh, now I'm going to be autobiographical, it says M on my driver's license, these aren't real. I would like them to be real. If I do an event, you know, 2 years from now, they may be real. I am trying to figure out whether I want to do that. Some of us go through a legal name change process. Some of us say, yeah, you know, that's what it said on the documents, but I'd like you to call me something else. And even that process is narrative, right? All of us think about doing that before we do it. So the talking time capsule that goes into the ground and thinks about coming out, which there are other kinds of coming out, right? Cisgender people come out as gay all the time, obviously, or as bi, or as asexual, which is also a thing that people have to explain. People come out as atheists in very religious contexts where that's a surprise and it's not what the grown-ups expect. People come out as religious in strongly anti-religious contexts, right? People undergo religious conversion. Coming out is a frame that can describe experiences that aren't about gender or sexuality, but most commonly it is, and in my work that's sort of where it goes first. People say at some point in the future, I'm going to do these things that make the story of my life over time a much happier story, that make it the story I want to live in. I'm not ready to do them. I can't do them yet. And sometimes that's I'm not emotionally ready. Sometimes that's I need to get tenure first. Sometimes that's that would be time consuming. This is actually a thing for me. There are things I think about doing now that my kids are 6 and 11. And I know that my partner would be supportive, that I would not have wanted to do, they would not have made me happy in the story I tell about my life when my kids were, 1 and 5. Because of the amount of focus required and the sort of household distraction, right? So I thought that I have had is maybe I'll do this, but not yet. And those are the thoughts that the time capsule is having. And the thoughts that the matches in the matchbox are having, which are much more melancholy thoughts, are what if the anger or the frustration or the difficulty created by being someone whose life doesn't match itself, what if that's actually what makes me interesting? Right? What if my creativity comes from not having made a full transition, from having to explain myself to people, from the conflict that's created by sort of being gender variant and moving through the world? What will be left of me? What happens to my identity when I am at the happy ending of the story that a lot of trans people tell about ourselves? And Jenny Boylan, who is super successful, has actually confronted that and talked about it indirectly because she wrote the great sort of transfeminine transition memoir that's a lot of fun, that has explained to a lot of people what exactly is going on. And it's some parts of it are dated now. And she knows that she's talked about that. But that established her as someone who could write trade press books that sold, that were fun as a memoirist. And she wrote 2 more memoirs. And she wrote sort of middle grade fiction. And you can sort of see, at one point she took a poll on I think, Twitter. What should my next book be? What should my next project be? Because she's done writing trans memoir. And right now, she's a terrific op-ed columnist for the New York Times. But I don't think she wants that to be her only thing. I think she's back to writing fiction. When she was writing adult realist fiction in the manner of somebody like Tom Perata, like a really talented comic novelist, before her transition. So will I be used up when all of the fire is burned out, when I no longer have a frictiony thing to be angry about? And what would I be like if I had been allowed to grow as natural wood and not sort of been made into this artificial thing, made straight, right? Made straight and phallic when I don't want to be. That's what the Matchbox poem is about, and it's a little grumpier. But I hope it's fun to hear. So, anyway, that was a good answer. I don't know whether there's one more question, but I feel like there might be.
Yeah. Well, this kind of is about both trans individuality and your poetry. It seems
okay.
Like
strangely, my poetry is often about trans individuality.
Well, it seems to be, especially in the one book, the 60 poems, it's about like bridging a generation gap.
Oh yeah.
And there seems to be like I know I was raised by like a 90s lesbian. Which is like inherently different than like a lesbian today. So I've had like a little bit of like her friends around younger lesbians is a very odd thing to watch. Just because there's like a bit of culture clash. Mm-hmm. It's just like, it seems like that happens with poetry and trans, like just a little bit of.
So like Melissa Etheridge is playing in like your mom's house. Like, oh my god, that's so sappy. That right?
Like we had to watch, like I watched, had to watch Whale Rider all the time, or Winona Ryder. That was
wait,
like
Whale Rider's a good movie.
I know, but like, I don't know why she won't. Like it was just really like the lesbians of the '90s. Like, I watched it like 5 times. And Anita Franco.
Oh yeah. Well, the.
It just seems like there's a culture clash in both, like dealing with poets. And dealing with gender and sexuality and all the whole gamut. And I just wondered how you dealt with that as like a member of either the older middle generation or something more about yourself.
Okay, so there is something really suspect when someone with a lot of institutional authority who's over 25 25 says that they sympathize in an unusual way with people younger than them. Right? You should really be suspicious anytime you hear anyone say that. That said, there seems to be a reason why I feel that way. And I feel like I belong to multiple generations. There are ways that I read and ways that I talk about literature that are really old, where I have that in common more with people who are now at retirement age that have to do with resistance to certain kinds of theory. And I feel like people who are my generation, when I was, like, in the 90s, were really into a kind of theory and believe, and now my peers have stopped believing it. Like, about how we're going to cause the revolution by, like, reading Dickens in a different way. That's not how it works. So there are ways in which I feel connected to people way older than me, and out of sync with my generation, and other ways in which I am absolutely part of my generation. The generation where sort of liberal parents say it's okay if you're gay, but we hope that you're not, and by the way, what is trans? And with liberal parents say this. By the time Riot Girl happened, and this is really important to me, but when Riot Girl happened was my first year of, when Riot Girl began, I was like doing college radio and I got to, you know, see an early Bikini Kill show and it was amazing. By the time it became clear that this wasn't just a really cool set of bands who made good music, but a transformative way to think about feminism and sexuality. And that in particular, it opened up a space where you could say, I don't belong in my gender, I'm a girl inside, without also saying, I am suicidal, I need to get surgery as soon as possible, right? It opened up sort of the genderqueer space. Does this make sense?
Yeah.
So genderqueer happens, and sort of queer solidarity happens, and the idea that there are ways to, you know, there were ways that I could be a girl without having to super medicalize myself and be wrong, make up stuff, right? By the time that became absolutely clear, it was 1994, 1995, and I had students. And I felt like there were ways that I was too old for it, and ways that it was absolutely sort of speaking to me. And it has continued to be the case, right, that saying, ways of being a girl and not a girl, ways of being sort of visibly trans, ways of saying, you know, I don't need to sort of do everything at once and like make a full social transition to be who I want to be in the world. Sort of ways of being out there that have been invented by people younger than me are right for me. And there are limits to ways that I can be that. So I feel like I belong to multiple generations in my life. And I really want to be part of this movement that started after me, and to be in that world sort of stylistically and emotionally without bigfooting anybody. It's happening in comics too right now. I don't know if anybody here reads comics. Superhero comics were and sort of all ages comics were really boring 10 years ago in a lot of ways, and now they're amazing, and there's all this stuff with trans representation and queer representation and sort of feminism and people of color, and also more writing, just more kinds of writers who want to write comic books. If you think that you might want to try comic books, there's so much going on right now. There's a comic called Gem and the Holograms that is based on it came from the bad movie that came from the old TV show. What, do you read Gem?
I watched the old cartoon from like the 80s.
Yeah, so that's really cheesy. That's like, I don't recommend that. But if you're interested in how to create, this gets back to your question about sort of youth and generations. This is a comic that's designed not to alienate readers who are 12. But if you're a grown-up and you see what they're doing with sort of femme style and with trans inclusion and also with sort of body type and with decisions about how you want your life to be, it's doing all this amazing work that looks back to X-Men comics I was reading in 1983, which were queer positive without being able to be too explicit about it, because, you know. But that I really, that's the visual world that I want to live in. And when the advice from the lights, when we were doing cover design on that, I sent them a bunch of images from Sophie Campbell's art for Gem and the Holograms and said, this is what I want the book to look like. We didn't end up hiring her to do the art. She's really busy. So this is a book that is younger than it is, and that I'm younger than I am in it. And at the same time, I'm sort of conscious that I have this institutional authority, and I have a responsibility for actual children, right? I live in a town that's one of those towns that's designed for you to bring up your kids. It's like the public schools are great. It's close to the city, but it's not the city. And find myself having to explain trans stuff to cis people and queer stuff to straight people over and over, and they really want to know. They really want to know. But I have to be the ambassador in a way that reminds me that I'm a parent, and these are people who are parents who are in their 30s and 40s, and a group of younger people with similar interests would already know. I feel like, Kate, was your hand up?
Yeah.
Do you want to ask the last question?
Yeah, I'm like still in the process of like formulating it, but I'll just go ahead. So I can tell kind of by the way you've been talking and like how you've been piecing together information, especially when you're talking about the Homeless Youth book.
Mm-hmm.
You two kind of have a little hyperactive mind in a way, because you obviously are interested in a lot of different things at the same time and how to go about narrowing and processing that. So I'm a freshman, and I've been going through this like past few weeks of just like realizing how there's certain ways of academic writing that I still need to learn, and going through learning that. So how do you go about being interested in so many different things, all different kinds of poetry at once, and narrowing? I know it's really difficult, and I know everyone's still learning, but like, what advice can you give to people that have a hard time narrowing, because they are too excited about everything? And that's a bold question, and I'm sorry, but I
don't
know.
No, that's actually like a really good craft question for the place to end. I try to have a couple things that at once that are creative or intellectual work, so if one gets frustrating, I can move to another.
Right.
I try to always have, with parenthood, I sort of always do, but before that, I sort of tried to always have something that was like, I'm doing good, I'm being a good person, this is practical. So when I felt like I couldn't think clearly, I would have something that I could do.
Mm-hmm.
I stop doing things when they're boring unless there is an ethical or intellectual necessity that I finish them. I don't finish novels I don't like unless there's some reason. I do finish books I have to read to write about a poet I do like. I do, finish taking out garbage, like, but I, in order to have time to do multiple things that I like, I stop doing things pretty quickly that someone else thinks would be fun for me that aren't fun for me. This also means I'm really bad with feature films and symphonies. I like pop songs and chamber music and poems and some novels but not others, and television, actually, because it comes in short. Should we stop? Let's stop. Thank you for your patience and your listening. If you think of a question later, like, email me. I have a Harvard address that's easy to find. I'm also on Twitter.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Steph. And I'll just do the quick final reminders. First of all, our final Visiting Writers Series event is coming up April 7th, 7 o'clock right here. Joshua Corey, who has just
released
a translation of Francais-Ponge, Partisan of Things, speaking of poems that are deeply invested in things.
It's called Partisan of Things?
Yeah, it's or on the part of things.
Well, yes, yeah, but it's...
Yeah, he went with Partisan of Things.
Wow.
Yeah.
That is making a big choice about how to view that book.
Yeah.
Of a very famous, seminal, frequently translated book. So it's an interesting take. It's going to be cool. He's going to come and talk to the translation class. That'll be that is coming up. And final little reminder, The Poem Is You is here for sale. We do credit cards, as is All Seasons Stephanie, and the broadsides as well. So come up, check them out, and join me in one more round of applause for Stephanie.